Hey everyone, today I'm gonna finish breaking down my comping example for the Charlie Parker tune Confirmation that I've been discussing, and all we have left to really get through here is the bridge section today. In the first three parts of this lesson, I already laid out in detail the general process for how I'm basically creating this idea or others like it, so I'm not gonna really do too much of that today, and I'm gonna try to move through this as quickly as I can for you. I'm also going to put up more of the chord diagrams today for the voicings that I'm using here, but keep in mind that it's also the rhythmic component of what's going on with the chords that is still just as much an integral part of this example and why the chord voicings may even sound good in the first place. Of course, I still have the PDF for this example available on my website and Patreon, and that includes the notation, the tabs, and the labels for the chords. And this could be very helpful, you know, when it comes to understanding and internalizing this whole thing. In my opinion, one of the biggest takeaways that we can get from an example like this is how, although the majority of the voicings that I play here are what I and likely a lot of other people would consider to be pretty stock or conventional and commonplace voicings that once you've known about for a little while, you may not think are anything, you know, particularly special or your favorite sounding chords or anything. The end result that I still produce here sounds pretty good and musical to me, and that might be subjective. What I play here may not be your exact taste in harmony or chords, but nevertheless, I still think that it's really important to understand how it's the context in which you may use any chord voicing that really has a huge impact on how that chord sounds to you in the moment, all right? And yes, we can still obviously appreciate any chord voicing, you know, just in an individual kind of way and comparatively, like, I like this chord better than this chord, especially comparing similar chords, like, I like this minor seven or just type of minor chord better than this one, but that matters, but I think it's important to really prioritize the context in which you're using your chords as well and understanding how to pick the right voicing for the right situation, all right? So, with all that said now, let's get into it, and I'm going to begin here by playing the bridge section of the recording for you, the whole 8 bars, just all at once, and then we'll take it from there. So, check this out. Alright, so first, I'm going to start like I usually do by playing the melody again for you here on the guitar, just so that we could establish it and clearly understand what we're working with here. All right, so basically, it goes like this. One, two, a one, two, three. Right, so that was okay. As we all know, this melody is very difficult to really phrase well and make it sound fluent, right? But anyway, now I'm going to play the comping example during the bridge as I sing the melody along with it so you can hear how it all generally goes together, all right? So here's the example. One, two, a one, two, three. Alright, so more or less, that's what we're going to be taking a look at now. Now, like I said before, I'm not going to go into too much detail today, but what I'll say now, just to make things easier for you, is that most of the voicings, I think pretty much all of them, except for one, turned out to be rhythmically hitting along with a melody note here, as opposed to filling up the space. And that's probably because the melody at this point in the bridge is pretty busy, you know, there's not a lot of room to fill up. So because of this, my options for voicings are generally easier for me to figure out because the top note of my voicing is usually going to match the melody note that's going on at that point, all right? So it's just good to keep that in mind. So, as far as the melodic content of the bridge goes, the first phrase actually begins in the bar before at the end of the first A section, and it basically comes in on the end of three, all right? When it goes one, two, three, right? And I'm actually harmonizing both those chords. This is what I play, all right? Now, we see that we're going into a C minor 7 chord in the first bar of the bridge, and that's what we're landing on there, right? This is just the top of a C minor 7 voicing, pretty stock. Instead of, you know, playing it like that, I'll put the root on top because that's what's going on in the melody, and I'm basically approaching it with this stock diminished chord. You may call that a D diminished. You know, in relationship to a C minor tonal center, I would see that as the 2 diminished, which again, if you see my videos, that functions basically like a 5 chord. So because we had space in the measure before, because we were just kind of hanging on like the F major chord for a while, we're basically inserting in like a tension chord here that's going to resolve nicely to the C minor tonic, or, you know, kind of seeing it like a tonic at the beginning of the bridge. So that's what's going on. 1, 2, 3. Right? Now, as the melody continues, we basically have this. 1, 2, 3. And that last note that I played is that note, and I'm going to harmonize that, right? Now, in this measure, it still shows C minor 7, but if we understand that we can kind of lump the whole 2 and 5 together, you know, C minor, F7, we can think F7 as well. So this voicing that I play is just a stock F9 voicing that happens to have that note on top. And I'm pretty sure I'm doing it with a longer articulation there too. I also did the diminished chord with a longer articulation. It just felt right. So it's like 1, 2, 3. Right? Now, the next couple of voicings are all kind of falling on the strong downbeats and are harmonizing whatever's going on in the melody there. Right? So the next strong downbeat would be on the downbeat of 1 in the next measure, and we could basically still think C7. So what do? I go 1, 2, 3. Right? Now that note I put on top, that's the note in the melody, and I'm basically playing, it's like an F7 sus chord. You know, if we took this F9, we can omit this third, and we can keep these two, and we can put the 11 on top, right? So we're just kind of variating that shape a little bit, but this is like an F7 sus. That's the note in the melody, and it works here. So, now the note that falls in a downbeat of 3 next is this note, and the perfect voicing to play here is your stock F7 sharp 9 chord, right? Because it's an F7 still, and that's the note in the melody, all right? And this is actually pretty interesting, because if you look at the last two bars, almost as like a chordal lick for like a 2-5, I'm basically playing like F9, like a pretty normal, like middle-of-the-road dominant chord as far as tension goes, and then I'm kind of playing it even more stable, kind of, you know, moving in the backwards direction away from the tonic to like an F7, and then I go to even more tense F-altered sound, right? And it's really cool how the melody just makes something like that work, because you might say that what I'm basically doing there is I'm playing 3 voicings in a row for F7, and I think sometimes when people are first starting to get into things like chord melody or figuring out how to put voicings together, you know, they may realize that if you just played a bunch of different voicings for the same chord, like one after another, it may not usually sound good, but with an example like this and with the melody dictating what's going on, it kind of shows you how you can do that in a way where it does sound good, because it's considering the melody. So there's a logical movement to these voicings here. Basically, 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? It sounds good. Now, after this, we're going to be resolving to the B flat major in the next bar, and we're going to land again on the downbeat of 1, and the melody note is that note. So perfect voicing to play is just your stock closed, you know, voicing of B flat major 7, all right? And then after that, I think the next one's in the upbeat. Let me see. Yeah, so that's on the and of 2. That's the first syncopation, but it's still harmonizing what's going on in the melody note there, which is that. And I'm playing this F major 6 voicing. I got the root, 6, 3rd, and the 6 again. I doubled the 6, right? And that one I'm doing with more of a long articulation there, because it just felt right, all right? And then after that, I think it's on the and of 4 to kind of anticipate, you know, beat 1 of the next measure, which is still B flat major, and I'm playing this, you know, B flat 13 voicing. So it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, and 3, 4, right? and then the next bar and basically leaving space. And yes, I know I'm leaving space there, so is the melody. I could have filled it up, but it just made sense to let it breathe a little bit there for me. All right, so already we're done with the first four bars of the bridge here. So moving along, next we have another 2-5-1 progression, now in the key of D-flat major. So we have a whole measure of E-flat minor 7, a whole measure of A-flat 7, and then whole measure of D-flat major. So with the melody, you know, the next phrase, right, it kind of, you know, starts on the and of 4, but then it lands on this, right? Now, this is the downbeat of 1 again, and the harmony is E-flat minor 7. The perfect voicing to play here is the very basic and simple E-flat minor 7 shell voicing, because it has that note, the flat 7, on top, all right? So doesn't matter if it's basic, if it has, you know, colored notes in it or not. It's the right voicing to use here. And I'm letting this one ring out a little bit more for a little bit of a contrast. So if you hear it coming from before, da 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 da, 2-3-4, da 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 da, and those two strong notes, ba-da-ba-da, I think that's 2-3-4 on the and of 1. 1-2-3, like a Charleston rhythm starting in on the end of 1. So now the harmony in this next measure is A-flat 7. So basically I'm doing, and I have this, you know, A-flat 13 voicing, just like an upper structure. Take a chord like this and put the root on top. And then I'm going to take that 13 and lower it to flat 13, sharp 5, still A-flat 7. And then the next chord that I'm playing is in anticipation of beat 1 of the next measure, which is D-flat major. So that I'm playing on the and of 4. It's like 1-2-3, right? Now, this one, technically that note on top there, you know, that's the part where it goes, right? In the last half of beat 4, in the measure before, it has these two 16th notes, and then it, like, resolves to that note on the downbeat in the next measure. And that's the note that I'm harmonizing, the third of D-flat major 7, but I'm actually playing my chord on the and of 4 right before, which is technically not exactly lining up with the note, but rhythmically speaking, you know, in regards to what I'm doing with my comping, it made sense to syncopate that there. It didn't feel right to play that on the downbeat of 1, all right? So that whole passage there basically is like 1-2-3-4. Now, that phrase goes by, and then the next chord is the only one that I play here that's filling up some space, because it felt natural. It's like, and the chord I play is this chord, all right? Now, this is on the and of 4 here, and this is really just an anticipation of the next measure, and the downbeat there would be G minor 7, because the last measure of the bridge here is a quick 2-5, you know, going back to F major, right? So I'm playing this stock third inversion G minor 7 voicing here, and I'm choosing this voicing because this note on top is what the melody note will be on the and of 1 in the following measure. So just kind of give you some context. Right now, after that, the phrase continues, and the last two chords are hang along with the melody. So the next one, you know, it's really cool the way it works. I started with this G minor 7, the phrase going. All right, now this is the next note that I'm harmonizing, and I'm thinking C7, and I play this. Okay, it has that same melody note on top, but I'm playing a G flat 9 chord, which of course is just your tritone substitution of C7, so it works just the same, and it sounds great here. Right, so 1-2-3-4, right, and the last note, that's the melody note, and we're anticipating beat 1 of the next measure. We're resolving to F major, of course, and I'm playing this upper structure, you know, F6-9 thing without the root. You got the 3rd, the 6th, the 9th, and the 5th, all right? And this last quick 2-5, again, is another cool example, because all three of those voicings, they're all stock, regular voicings that, you know, on their own, you may not think are anything too special, but you put them together in an example like this, where the melody dictates, you know, the musical ideas, and you get some good results. 1, 2, 3, 4. And that middle one, I do with that long articulation. Again, for the contrast, you can really hear how it makes it swing. One more time. 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? So that's basically it as far as the bridge goes here. So there's nothing really else to explore as far as this example goes. What I'll do for you right now is I'll play the entire example for you, the whole form for confirmation, and I'll do it along with like a drum backing track just so you can really clearly hear it in time. And then we'll just, you know, take it out from there. All right? So hope you enjoy. 'Gonna leave it there today. I'm really happy that I'm finally done with the breakdown of this example because this took a lot longer than I thought. You know, I've been really busy lately though, but I'm just happy to be finished. All right, so if anyone has any questions or anything they want to say, please put it in the comments. I'm here to help. And in the next episode,
hope you're ready for the next episode. Hey,
you know, since we finally finished breaking this example down, now I can go into how exactly I may go about practicing chordal types of ideas, and that is what I'm going to get into, but I think I'm going to do this other video first that I'm just kind of really interested in at the moment, and it's kind of random, but there's a reason why I wanted to do this video. It's not too significant, but I want to do this before I really go into how I practice chordal ideas, or at least working them into the hands like I've been talking about, alright? So I think it'll be an interesting one next episode, so I hope you're excited for that. So anyway, that's it. If you enjoyed this video, I would really appreciate it if you gave it a like and consider becoming a subscriber as well as a contributor to Patreon, where you'll get all the PDFs on this channel for only $5 a month. And if you think anyone else would enjoy the content, please share it with them as well. And I will see you guys in episode 80.
Swinging and playing the blues. That's what we about.
I'm trying to help you.